Don't let your life pass you by. Weep not for the memories. Remember the good times that we had. Let them slip away from us when things go. I saw you smiling in the sun. Wanna feel your warmth upon me. Wanna be the one. I will remember you. Will you remember me? Don't let you.
And let me choose. Well, once there was a darkness, a deep and endless night. You gave me everything you had. Oh, you gave me life. And I will remember you. Will you remember me?
Welcome, everyone. All of you that have come here today, and those who are joining us virtually. Thank you for your presence as we share in the service of love for Daniel William Anthony Urbanowski. On behalf of Dan's family, I would like to say a heartfelt thank you for making the time to be with them today. Dan's death is most tragic and is bound to bring shock and sorrow to those who loved and befriended him. When people we love are taken from our midst too soon, we struggle to deal with their absence. That is why it is important for us to collectively acknowledge and accept that the world has changed with Dan's passing. It is natural that we should be sad today because Dan is no longer a part of our lives. Together, let us open our hearts, remember and celebrate the impact that Dan had on us. He did live for 72 wonderful years, and that's what we will celebrate today. 72 years of life, love, laughter, friends, and family. Together, let us open our hearts and begin with a moment of silence to quiet them. Thank you. My name is Sandra Sorkin, and I am a life celebrant I'm here to guide you and support you through the service today. I feel very privileged to have met Sandra and for joining all of you as we look back, reflect, and celebrate Dan. If you haven't already done so, could you please make sure your cell phones are turned off? Sandra, I know that everyone here joins me in offering our deepest condolences on the loss of your partner and best friend of 24 years. So many things that happen in life just don't make sense, and we know there are no words that we can say to take away your pain. Today, you are surrounded by people who love and care about you. They are proof that Dan made a difference to many. Your friends and family want to help in any way they can, so please don't hesitate to lean on them. It's good for you, and it's good for them as well. I hope you find some peace and comfort in the many memories and stories that will be shared today. I love this quote by Mahatma Gandhi on loss. It will be the little things that you will remember, the quiet moments, the smiles, the laughter, and although it may seem hard right now, it will be the memories of these little things that help to push away the pain and bring the smiles back again. To Dan's brother, Reg, and his wife, Alicia, when a sibling dies, the world changes in a heartbeat. Each family has its own special history and the shared bonds that are part of that history. You have had your entire life with Dan and therefore have made many treasured memories with him. I know that your memories and your love for him will keep him alive in your hearts forever. I wish you peace and love as you begin life without your brother. My condolences to all of you. To Sandra's family, Reg's family, Dan's dear friends and co-workers, you are here today because Dan mattered to you. He made a difference in your lives and you want to honor him. I encourage you to remember the laughter, the love, the joy that Dan brought into this world. May his memory continue to inspire and uplift all of you as you navigate this world without him. I hope that as you listen to the stories and share your memories with us and others, it brings you comfort. I hope that you will have the courage to smile, to laugh, and to cry. My heart goes out to all of you at this very difficult time. As you grieve for the loss of Dan, please know that no two people will grieve the same because everyone here had their own special relationship with him. Grief is a personal journey. We cry differently, we cope differently, we mourn differently, and that's all right. It is not an illness that one may quickly get over. Instead, it affects a person forever. What changes is that you learn new ways of coping and dealing with the death so that it is not so emotionally raw anymore. Know that whatever it is you are feeling today is perfectly okay. The journey of grief can be compared to the ebb and flow of the ocean waves, and I love this little story about grief. Immediately after losing a loved one, the waves are 100 feet tall and crash all over you. They come 10 seconds apart and don't even give you time to catch your breath. Everything around you reminds you of the person that was. After a while, maybe weeks, maybe months, you'll find the waves are still 100 feet tall. But they come further apart. When they come, they still crash over you, but in between, you can breathe, you can function. You never know what's going to trigger the grief. It might be a song, a picture, going on a hike, and the waves come crashing. But in between the waves, there is life. Somewhere down the line, and it's different for everybody, you find the waves are only 80 feet tall. Or 50 feet tall, and while they still come, they come further apart. Now you can see them coming, an anniversary, a birthday, Christmas. You can see it coming for the most part, and now you try to prepare yourself, and when it washes over you, you know that somehow you will again come out the other side. The waves never stop coming, and you don't really want them to, but you learn that you'll survive them, and other waves will come, and you'll survive them too. You will always mourn Dan. You will always miss him. And there will always be the feeling that someone is missing. I hope that in time the tears will be replaced with smiles, laughter, and gratitude for having such a wonderful man in your lives. In honor of and in memory of Dan, I'd now like to call on his brother Reg to light a candle. It's over here. The light of the flame has always been symbolic to the human world. The eternal flame stands for the remembrance of those gone before. The light of a candle has come to represent rebirth and renewal. Let it then symbolize the renewal we must seek as we continue life without Dan. Let the light signify the ever-present love and memories which will live on in our hearts. So long as we live, Dan shall live on too, for he is now a part of us as we remember him. Please welcome Brenda, Sandra's sister, to read a poem.
I am the wind in the trees and the song of a bird. I am moonbeams in the midnight sky and a glorious rainbow after the storm. I am morning dew and freshly fallen snow. I am a butterfly flying overhead and a puppy happily at play. I am a gentle touch, a warm embrace. Open your heart to know I am not gone. Reach deep into your soul. You will find me. I am here. Have no fear. I am with you always.
That's a beautiful poem. Thank you, Brenda. Please welcome Jesse, Dan's nephew, to share some words of remembrance.
In the many years that Dan's been part of our family, he's had the opportunity to leave us with a lot of happy memories. Thank you for being here to remember them with us, and I'd like to share some that our family had to discuss over the last little while. Dan met my Aunt Sandra at the Fort Saskatchewan Correctional Center, where they were both working in 2000. It was quite a distance from the parking lot into the office, and they got to know each other when they arrived at work at the same time and chatted on that long daily trek through all the various buildings to their offices. Dan's brown eyes and characteristic friendly personality made the visits all the more enjoyable. Early in his career, having spent a year at university studying agriculture, Dan decided to pursue trades, becoming an electrician and power engineer working in government on infrastructure. He served with the government of Alberta in this capacity for 32 years, most of them in management, before retiring in May of 2014. Dan loved food and going out for meals, especially breakfast. Visits to Moose Jaw were most fulfilling when they included a stop at the Vetmore Art Gallery for lunch and supper at Houston Pizza. Dan seldom left the art gallery without purchasing a wristwatch or fountain pen for his collection. From Houston's, it was a pizza, and it had to be a big one. He also enjoyed music, sports, traditional holidays, cars, and adding to his collection of watches, knives, and fountain pens. When I graduated from university, Dan gifted me a knife that became my truck knife, and I liked it a lot, and I learned that Dan, when he gifted you something, it was something nice. somebody else felt they needed the knife more than I did because I left it in the truck once. And a few years ago, he gifted me another knife. And I like this one too. But it meant a lot that he thought of me. It was on a summer trip to Buffalo Pound Park that I and many of our extensive family had the opportunity to meet Dan for the first time. As family camping tradition dictates, in the evening, a small gathering of 200 to 300 of us will gather with our lawn chairs in a big circle where we converse, tell stories, and share snacks around a nice campfire. Others will recall that sometime after introductions and pleasantries were exchanged, Dan became bored with all the sitting around and asked Sandra, "Are we just going to keep sitting around? Doesn't anyone have a guitar so we can do a sing-along?" It seemed like Dan just needed a bit of a reprieve from hearing family stories about people he'd never met. When no musical instruments were produced, Dan settled for a hike up Old Smoky, the favorite climbing hill, instead. It is certainly true that Dan enjoyed sports, music, and the outdoors, and not just from the perspective of a spectator. For while he loved taking in outdoor music, festivals with Sandra, and watching Oilers hockey, and wouldn't he just be so excited to see them hitting to Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Finals tomorrow night, he had a particular love for being active himself, and be it hiking, preferably in the mountains, mountain biking, or racquetball, Dan liked to get at it when he was out and about. On one occasion, Dan, Sandra, and a number of my aunts and uncles met for a weekend of mountain biking at Peter Lougheed Park. Everyone had a great time laughing and riding, but the real entertainment began at the end of the trip when Dan began placing their bikes on the rack on the back of his car. Spectators recall a car and bikes so bubble wrapped they could roll down a canyon and come out the other end intact and unscratched. Everyone had a good-natured laugh with and at Dan over the whole ordeal. In truth, Dan was quite a rider in those days and had quite a collection of bikes to suit the various riding styles that he enjoyed. Following his retirement, a number of our family had the opportunity to do some traveling with Dan. Many recall some memorable moments of a trip to Cuba a few years back. Each evening, the group got together to play dice. When it was Dan's turn, he would shake the dice very, very thoroughly. Just when it seemed that the dots might fly right off the dice, he'd toss them across the table, and inevitably they fell on the floor every single time. Everyone had a lot of fun and laughter playing and observing his exuberant tosses of the dice. On a more sober note, while the group was swimming in the ocean, someone happened to look and see Dan being pulled out by the retreating waves, with only his eyes and nose poking out of the water. They hustled to pull him in unharmed, but it was a close call. With dry land entertainment proving to be the safer bet, Dan and a few others went on a tour of a farm. During the expedition, Dan kept mumbling unfavorable comments about communism, all while touring a communist country, while Sandra did her best to shush him up. On another occasion, Dan and Sandra joined family on a trip to Palm Springs. On an evening walk through the old part of town, visiting outdoor booths and flea markets, Dan grew tired of the walking and decided to go back to the car to wait for the rest of the group to finish. Nobody had noticed that they had parked right in front of an adult novelty shop. Right in the front window was a mannequin dressed in leather underwear, gesturing a few tools and props. At least Dan had something to intrigue him until the rest of the group returned. Back on his own turf, Dan was a man who loved his vehicles. And he cycled through a number of them in the years after joining the family. When we first met Dan, he was driving a worn-out Dodge Neon car. A couple years later, it was stolen, which may have seemed almost providential to Dan. Well, wouldn't you know it, a few days later, Dan received a phone call from the police stating that his vehicle had been recovered somewhere in BC. Darn it. Eventually, however, the Neon went down the road in favor of something nicer and newer. Well, Dan was trying out several new cars and SUVs before becoming a Ford aficionado and settling on a Ford Raptor truck. Once he got these newer vehicles, Sandra would say that he wouldn't let her drive them anymore. They were spotless, and it almost became necessary for you to take your shoes off before getting in. There was a little piece of paper from the car manufacturer on the floor that he wanted you to be sure to put your feet on so you didn't get the floor mats dirty. And heaven help you if you put a fingerprint on his dash or the windows. To know Dan was to know that he was somewhat of a perfectionist. This manifested itself in most aspects of his life. When it came to trade skills, building and repairs, he might have conceded that there were two ways to skin a cat, the right way and the wrong way. His tools were always of excellent quality and very neatly arranged. One weekend, when some family attended a home show with Dan and Sandra in Edmonton, and Mike Holmes of home renovation fame was describing how to fix up a basement, Dan was fairly dubious of Mike's suggested methods, as Dan himself was a perfectionist with his projects. Dan's ethic for high standards was not limited to his work or the particular arrangement of his watch collection on its shelf. He always took great care of his personal grooming and appearance. In the morning before Dan made an appearance before company, he always spent some time in the bathroom and always came out very well groomed, shirt tucked in, clean modern clothes on, not a hair out of place, splash of cologne and a smile on his face. Moreover, speaking of company, Dan went to great pains to ensure guests in their home were comfortable and well served. Mike would often stay with Sandra and Dan while visiting clients in Alberta. It became a ritual that on Thursday nights when Mike had returned from seeing his last client, Dan would be patiently waiting to visit and have a rum and coke ready for Mike and himself to share as they enjoyed a nice conversation. When Russ came up visiting one time, Sandra would phone home during the day to find out how things were going. Dan would always say, "Just fine, but could you bring a pie home for supper?" As soon as he hung up, he would say to Russ, "I can never get her to bring a pie home." When Russ mentioned that he wanted to make a sandwich for himself, Dan, being the ultimate host, said, "No, I'll make it for you." And he did. Indeed, to say that Dan was a perfectionist would be correct. To say that he was fussy to the extreme with his vehicles and settled for only the best that he could manage with his tools, his toys, and his appearance would also be true. And to someone who didn't really know Dan, this description might lead one to picture a man with an air of arrogance or uppity superiority. This assessment could not be further from the truth. Dan was simply a pleasant, hard-working, conscientious person who appreciated quality and order, all personality traits that each of us came to admire the better we got to know him. As warm as each of these memories are, and as special as it is to share them as a group, Dan's story would be lacking if not for the details of one who loved and knew him best, that's Sandra. Daniel Wiltham William Anthony Urbanowski, D-Wow, as I called him, kind of like ShamWow. He wasn't always D-Wow. He used to be Duh. Daniel Anthony Urbanowski. When I applied for a passport for Dan some years ago, we discovered that he'd been born and baptized with William in his name, but in the less formal naming style of time, it was casually dropped over time. My sleuthing to the Bonneville Catholic Diocese for baptismal records uncovered the truth. We got his documentation updated and got the passport. D-Wow stuck. It was more fun than Duh, and it became our inside joke. Dan and I met in jail, and it made a great response when people asked how we met. The looks on their faces was priceless. We were not criminals. Both worked within the correctional facility, Dan for Alberta Infrastructure and I for Grant MacEwan College. Dan, I would quickly learn, was devoted to his work. He started his career farming, then shifted to the trades as an electrician and power engineer. He moved into government and became a manager. He spent the rest of his career with Alberta Infrastructure throughout its various names. He was passionate about his work and doing a good job. He was demanding of himself and others. I often wanted to apologize to the people who reported to him as their manager. I would not want to have worked for him. he was a hard apple, or something like that. Despite his high expectations and nose to the grindstone style, he often came home and told me what wonderful, talented, and hardworking people he worked with. He would share funny stories about the laughs they had at work, and I was relieved that it was not all work. There was levity, there was fun. The people he worked with likely never were aware of how much he valued them and how much he felt supported by them. One of his most cherished work experiences were the three or four times he was able to join the Buffalo Roundup at Elk Island Park. Each of those years, he spent the full day outside in cold November weather, helping the veterinarians and staff to channel those magnificent and powerful wild animals where they did not want to go, so their health could be monitored. It also earned him the nickname Buffalo Dan in some parts of our family. So. Dan liked to play racquetball and was pretty good at it. He tried to teach me and just couldn't seem to resist smashing the ball so hard that a rookie like me had to dive for cover. Oh, sorry, he'd say. Then could not help doing it again. We developed a competitive relationship. We used to cycle. I introduced that to him and bought him a mountain bike as a gift. We would inevitably end up racing each other. When he thought one tiny rubber thread of his front tire passed mine, and it didn't, he triumphed and said, "This is where conditioning comes in." He fancied his regular gym workout routines gave him an edge. Imagine that. Do I think that it is unfair that I now have the last word? Not a bit. Winning is everything, apparently. Sorry, Dan. One of Dan's favorite things to do was to go hiking, especially in the mountains. We often went to Kananaskis and Canmore, stayed in one of the many wonderful bed and breakfasts, and went for vigorous hikes. One birthday, I surprised him by booking a helicopter ride. He loved it and was in awe of the bird's eye view he got of the mountains, rivers, and valleys of one of his favorite places on Earth. With retirement, there came the opportunity to travel. He finally put that passport to use with trips to Mexico, Ireland, Scotland, and Palm Springs. To learn to sail, a course offered in British Columbia didn't require a passport, but it was a highlight he spoke about for many years after. Likewise, trips to Halifax and Winnipeg to visit his family were equally memorable for him. Thank you to everyone who shared those experiences with us. John, Wendy, Gail, Jim, Brenda, Mike, Lori, Barry, Alyssa, and Reg. Thank you to all of you, family, friends, colleagues. He loved you all.
Thank you, Jesse. That was an incredible tribute to your uncle. And I'm sure he's very proud of you today for doing that. I'd now like to call on Reg, Dan's brother, to pay tribute to his.
Thank you. Well, I have the distinct honor of talking to you as Dan's little brother. And there were so many things that I could talk about, but I'm just going to talk about a few because I don't want to talk your head off. But I'm going to start with a picture, because when I heard of Dan's passing, I immediately ran to our pictures. And the earliest one I could find was from December 1954. So Dan was born in 1951. I was born mid-December 1954. So there was Dan, 3 years old, holding me in his arms. His eyes, as big as saucers, looking at the camera as if to say, "Really? My whole life?" And it went from there. You know, my big brother was, first of all, my hero. He achieved so many things. Now, some of you may know that he was actually royalty. He was actually nominated and won to the title Prince of Bonneville when he was 4 years old. Now, if you can imagine Danny sitting there with his little vest, his hair is Brill creamed. I don't know if any of you remember Brill cream. I don't need it anymore, but everybody Brill creamed, and Dad used a lot of Brill cream, so it was fitting that Dan had. But he sat there like this, and it was regal, right? But you know what? I mean, it was just a symbol of the things that were to come for Dan and how I saw him in my eyes. He joined Lufto, in Bonneville, which is where we were from, at that time was a town of about 800,000 people, half French, half English. My family, half French, half English. My mother was French, my father was English, and we lived on Main Street. It's an odd thing. But we joined Lufto, which is the French version of Cubs. And one of the other pictures that we had is Danny, because he was a Sixer, which meant he was a leader of a troop, right? He's got the little stripes here to mark that. And we had these blue wool, very itchy shirts that you wore and blue berets. And we were both doing this, right? And I thought, yes, that's it. Dan did it, and I'm with him all the way on this. And I did those kind of things, right? Dan did piano, and he had piano recitals. He was very good at it. Unfortunately, I'm not that inclined. Tried it, but it didn't work for me. But where Danny excelled? Hockey. He was really good at hockey. Peewees, all the way through to bantams and to midgets. And we went to his games, we cheered him on, we bought the burgers, you do it, you know, and you're cheering folks, especially when they played St. Paul, because that was like that's our nemesis community, right, if you're from Bonneville. I tried Pee-wee's, wasn't that good at that either, but you know what, he took the time and we played back alley hockey, because behind us was a back alley. We would take oil cans, back in the days when cars had oil cans, put two of those, because we lived next to a garage, which was what my dad owned, and we put those on, and those were the goal posts. And I'd get the goalie stick. For some reason, I was always the goalie. We get the broken goalie sticks from behind the rink, when, you know, when the men were playing, and they toss them out. So I'd be the goalie, and he'd be the forward. He always played defense, but he'd like to slap around that puck. And when it was too cold, we actually played in our bedroom. Now, our house was a two-bedroom house, one level, about 800 square feet, and Dan and I shared a bedroom, so we had bunk beds. And there was a desk. Now, the only place that you could actually put a goal if you were gonna play in the bedroom was in front of the window. Yeah, exactly, right? And so we thought, well, you can't use anything that's gonna break the window, so we'll use socks. Now, Danny had a wicked slap shot, and we had those single pane glasses. Three times we broke the window. Yeah, and then, yeah, finally Mom and Dad said, yeah, that's enough, really? And so we stopped that. Danny also played the accordion. You know, you were talking around the lake, shouldn't we play guitar? You know where that comes from, I think? When we were at the lake as kids, and it was a wonderful, wonderful time, we had kitchen parties. People would gather around. There'd be Leo Lemaire on the banjo, the McNally's on the fiddle and on the guitar, and who's at the piano? Danny. And if Mrs. McNally went to the piano, Danny took out his accordion. Now, Danny played the accordion. He didn't like to admit that in older years for some reason. And I always thought that was so cool, because this thing was like huge on him, right? And he's got this little purple accordion and he's doing na 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 na. You know, I look back at that thing a few months ago. It's only that big, right? But that's how big it seemed at the time. And he played these instruments, and they loved it. And all the kids are dancing around, so that's where I think he got that idea of sitting around and just having fun and singing, right? Yeah, we used to do so much stuff together. He also played baseball, an avid sports fan, right down to the uniform. First base, that was Danny. First base. I tried first base. Because I, you know, he's my hero. smacked in the forehead with a baseball, and that was the end of that. I'm going to the outfield, right? So that was that. But you know, he had trophies for some of his stuff and certificates. He had trophies for his hockey prowess. He had certificates for his recitals. Didn't want to hang him up. That wasn't the point of this. The point was that he just wanted to do and be his best at what he did. And he taught me that, I think, throughout what he was doing, right? Danny was also my rock and my beacon. You know, one of the things that I realized early on, and we would talk about this, is that sometimes I was a pretty big handful for my big brother. You know, because I was a little wired sometimes. And one of the things that Danny did is he was a senior altar server. Now, for those of you that are Catholic, there's that process, right? You start off as an apprentice and you work your way up. Danny was the senior. I wanted to be an altar server because Dan was an altar server, right? But to be the apprentice altar server meant you got up at 6 in the morning during weekdays and you went over to the church 5 or 6 blocks with Dan. You'd get into the back of the church in the wintertime. You'd light the space heater up so it would be nice and warm for when the priest came in. And then you held a mass and you just followed him around because Dan did all the heavy lifting, right? He did carrying of the host and the water, he rang the bell, and all of that kind of stuff. And there's only like 7 or 10 people in there, but you would learn eventually how to do things by watching, and then he'd give you little things to do. Well, one of the things that I really wanted to do is ring the bell. Right, so those of you that remember the old ways that they used to do the mass, is it was Latin. And the priest faced away from the crowd, and as the altar servers were there, you knelt on the altar, right? And then as they're getting the communion ready, the altar servers would have, so there'd be me, there'd be this bell, which was this beautiful brass thing that had like 6 bells on it and a handle, and then Dan, right? So normally Dan was ringing. He said, okay, I'll let you ring the bell this time. So the trick in ringing the bell is that timing, right? Because the priest, I don't remember which one goes first, the host or the chalice, but he raises this, and as he's raising it, you ring the bell, and then people put their head down and they say a little prayer. And then it comes back down, and then the priest will raise the chalice, and you ring the bell and people put their head down, right? That's the way it's supposed to go. Timing is everything. And the key is to have a nice, soft, gentle ring of the bell. The first one I got down pretty good. Second one didn't work very well at all. So the priest went up, the priest went up with the host, and as he was going up, I grabbed the bell, ring a ring a ring, make the angels sing. Well, Father Lassonde, who was the priest, gave me one of these stern looks. I looked at the 7 or 10 people that were in there. Nobody had their head down because they were all looking at me. And I'm smiling, right? I'm oblivious to the obvious because I'm 9 years old and Dan is 12. And I thought, well, I should look at Dan. I look at Dan. Now he's muttering something. I'm assuming it's a prayer. That's what I want to believe, right? So now comes the key part, the second raising, the chalice. So the chalice is raising, and I'm beaming, because I thought I did really good. Reach over for the bell, and I feel this hand on my hand. And he gently lifts my hand and rings the bell, and down it goes. And I learned then that that's the way you do it, right? Dan also taught me how to ride a bike. Now, you know, that stoicism that he had when he was at the altar there was paying attention. That kind of happened with riding the bike too. So those of you that know Dan in adult years, this was the same stuff. It's just, he's 12 years old and he's doing this, right? So the first thing he does is, so I'm inheriting his bike, which I think is really cool because he gets a 3-speed, which was top of the line back then, right? I get the old purple bike with the solid rubber tires and the little streamers that come out of the handlebars. And then you tie the, you close pin the playing card to the wheel so it makes as you're going, yeah, that was me, right? That Danny was giving me his bike. So it was after supper, we cross through the backyard, we go across the alley through Aunt Jeanette's yard into the old schoolyard. Now the old schoolyard had a big U-shaped kind of driveway, gravel, all right? So Dan says, okay, get on the bike, there's no training wheels, right? This is pre-training wheel days or something. So get on the bike and I'll just push you and you'll go fine. So I get on the bike and he's pushing me and then he just like it. And I'm doing this, fall over. I get gravel, you know how you get that gravel under your skin and it's like bleeding. And I don't want to do this anymore. It's stupid. And then he says, calm down, Richard. And he's picking these little rocks out from my knee, right? And he said, do it again. I'll run beside you. So that's what we did. Three times it took before he actually let me go. He'd never let me go until it was time. So we ran all the way around. And he said, okay, I'm going to let you go. And I go, no, no, no. Okay. Turn around. Run again and run again. And it wasn't until I was ready that he actually let me go. That was my big brother, right? Years later, in high school, I was not doing very well. In fact, in my first term, the fall term of my grade 12, they were going to kick me out. My grades were extremely poor. I was hanging around with the wrong people. And Mom sent Danny to talk to me. And I remember that very clearly in the basement. He's sitting in the green poof chair. And he had this sort of, that was his study area, because by then he wasn't taking his training. And he had it all laid out for himself. And he talked to me. He wasn't stern. There was no yelling. What was I going to do with my life? Because we were at a crossroads. Right? And he brought me through to a point where I said, fine, I'll finish high school. And he sat with me. So every night, we studied together. I was finally allowed into that basement study area, and we worked together, and I finished high school. And on the way to finishing high school, he says, so what are you going to do after? I said, well, I want to be a therapist. He says, okay, fine. You can apply to be a therapist. So I applied to occupational therapy at the U of A, and he said, you've got to have the grades. Now, I ended up with a 69, which doesn't sound like a lot, but when you consider where I was in the fall in the 30s and 40s, that was a miracle, and I thank my brother for that. So I applied for occupational therapy. Then after I finished high school, I went to work for the summer in Quebec in a hospital. I thought, well, I'll phone back every week, see what happens, right? So I kept phoning back, and nothing, nothing, nothing. And then one time I phoned, and Mom says, well, Danny will talk to you. So Danny came on the phone. He said, you didn't get in. I said, what? He said, you didn't get in. I said, well, I'm done. I said, I got a job here in Sherbrooke. I'm working off the loading dock. I'm just going to stay here for a year. To heck with this university stuff. He said, no. He says, you can't give up on your dream like that. And we went back and forth. He would call me twice a week for the next few weeks. Finally, he and Marcel, my cousin, convinced me that this is something that I should do. Come back to the U of A, register in an arts program, and then try again the next year to get into OT. As luck would have it, first day of classes at the U of A, somebody dropped out of the occupational therapy program, and I was next on the list and I got in. You see, that stuff that he had when he held my hand or showed me how to ride a bike, that helped me. And that helped me make who I am today. I'm okay, Tien. I told Tien if I break down, you run up and catch me, right? You know what? But I also will say, more than anything else, Dan was my friend. All these things that we did together, it's an amazing symmetry. You know, they say that if the highest form of flattery is mimicry, and I just loved doing things with him, loved to do the things that he did, right? Even listening to Roy Orbison music and Gordon Lightfoot. And you know, it was funny, just to show you how close we all were together, Marcel, who was a cousin, but who was actually like a brother. The three of us one year we were at Christmas time. Mom hands out the gifts from under the tree, and there's like 20, 30 people there, right? So, and she hands out these three, one for me, one for Dan, one for Marcel, and they're all LPs. So we open it up, all the same LP, giving each other Rubber Soul by the Beatles, right? And we just cracked up. Well, see, there you go. There's a point in that. And I'm just going to reflect a little bit on the lake, because Moose Lake was, I think for Dan and I, a special place. At that time, Moose Lake was like a small municipal beach. It wasn't sort of the big, you know, things that you find now with all kinds of houses. There's like maybe 10 houses there. And we spent so much time walking together and just talking and playing and doing different things. You know, I remember I started, Danny was also an avid swimmer, and he did all his, of course he was, yeah. So, Reg is going to be an avid swimmer. So Mom registers me for beginners. It took me 3 times, but I passed beginners, which meant that you had to get up like around 6:30 in the morning at Moose Lake. Now, by then, the lake is pretty cold. Anyways. And Dan would have to walk me the 5 or 6 blocks from the cabin to the end of Vizzo Beach where the lessons were. And it wasn't so much the lessons that I valued as much as just walking with Dan in the morning, picking up a piece of grass and chewing it, talking about what we were gonna do during the day, maybe throwing some stones across the lake, making them skip, and just having a jolly old time. And there were times when the lesson was over, it would take us a long time to get home because we're busy catching grasshoppers or, you know, picking Saskatoons, those kind of things. And there's something about that big brother, little brother thing of just being. Does that make sense? And there's a lot of that, right? Our cabin was kind of down a hill, and the hill was a dirt road. So when it rained, it got really muddy. One of the funnest things we used to love to do was roll down that hill during a rain, get covered up in mud, and then run off the pier and just jump into the water. And it was a warm thing. A lot of fun that we had to do. But there was even, you know, the times after school when we would sit down and we played tiddlywinks. I don't know if anybody remembers playing. Did anybody ever play tiddlywinks? Okay. Or pick up sticks, right? And you played those kind of games. One of our favorite nights, though, at the house as a family was Saturday nights. You have supper, you have your bath, you get into your pajamas, Mom would make popcorn, and you sit in front of the black and white TV and watch Hockey Night in Canada, right? And we're watching Hockey Night in Canada, and because we had the antenna, it all of a sudden goes, and so I'll go fix it. And I go, okay, try the horizontal, right? No, try the vertical. And then you'd inevitably hear Dad say, Dan, go help your brother out or we'll never get any of the game. So Dan would come along and he'd go, there it is. And that was the way you had those Saturday nights or Sunday nights with Ed Sullivan and Bonanza. I mean, my gosh, those were wonderful times. And I remember those because they were small moments, but they made me who I was. And I would never be who I was without my brother Dan, right? And so that's all I wanted you to know today, is that Danny, who was his name when he was young, Danny as a boy, Danny as a teenager, became Danny the man. But all of that stuff that you saw in him as a man was there as a child, and it was wonderful to see. And I will also say that I remember, you know, you talk about Danny meeting Sandra. So this was, Danny had this wit about him that was kind of dry sometimes. I was coming in from working in Saskatchewan, and he says, I want you to meet somebody. I said, oh, he says, I've met someone, and I want to introduce you to her. So we hop in his truck, and we're headed off someplace. I says, well, where are we going? He says, we're going to meet somebody that I want to make my new girlfriend. I said, well, where are we going? He says, to the correctional center. I said, really? I said, okay. And he, you know, he's not letting on, right? And I'm going, but is the Fort Saskatchewan Correctional Center, is it a women's correctional center? He said, no. I said, oh. So we're meeting Sandra at the correctional center. That's how I that's where I first met you, Sandra, was in the correctional center. We were trying to remember that the other day. But you know what, Sandra? Thank you for being with Dan and being a sister, an aunt, and a great aunt. So, and you're with us for life. And I will say this about Dan. You know when I said that picture when he was 3 years old and his eyes were as big as saucers and, oh my God, I got this young boy for the rest of my life. When it's my time to cross over to the other side, here's what I foresee. Dan standing there, me running into his arms, and him turning to my mother with his eyes as big as saucers. Oh my God, now I got him for eternity. Thank you.
Reg, that was a beautiful tribute. I think today that you are Dan's hero for all those words of love. That was amazing. Thank you. And one last person would like to say a few words, and that's Sandra, Dan's partner, graciously requested to share her words of love for Dan.
This will be very short and sweet. First of all, my heart is touched by all of you being here today. Dan would have loved it, right? I wish he could have witnessed it. But thank you to Jesse, amazing. Thank you to Reg, amazing. And that's Dan. They represented him very well, and I thank you for it. And I thank all of you for being here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandra. As most of you know, she's a very strong lady, and I've admired her strength throughout this whole process. The one thing I forgot to mention, Reg, is one of the things I thought about while you were paying tribute to your brother was a quote that I heard that said, "The greatest gift our parents ever gave us was each other." That made me think of that. At this time, I'd like to introduce Shauna, Dan's niece, and Brooke, Dan's great niece, to perform a song in his honor.
Your work on earth is done. love for the Father and the Son. Oh, how we cried the day you left us. We gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see
made the service so much more special than it already was. It's beautiful. I also wanted to share with you some words from the tribute wall on the Serenity website. I went and read those last night from people who left their condolences. Here's how some of Dan's friends described him. A quality tradesperson, he always made me feel loved and accepted. A valued work friend and colleague. I've heard him break into song, and it always made me smile. So thank you to those who left those messages. I'd now like to invite everyone to turn your attention towards the screen behind me to enjoy the memorial slideshow.
Thank you.
So many wonderful memories. Yeah, and that's what you have to hold on to. Those memories are what will keep Dan alive forever. Sandra would like to pass on some thank yous to Serenity and their staff for guiding her through this very challenging time. Everyone who paid tribute to Dan today, who performed or read a poem. Everyone who has joined us virtually, thank you for being here. And of course, all of the family, friends, co-workers, and everyone who has reached out to her with words of comfort, hugs, and condolences, who have traveled to be here. Your kindness has truly been healing for her. Following the service, you are invited to stay and enjoy some fellowship and refreshments, and to continue to share your stories and memories of Dan with each other. My hope is that once you leave here today, you will continue to celebrate the fullness of Dan's 72 years and the impact he made on his world. You are now the ambassadors of his legacy. You can now take with you the best of what you gained from knowing him, his strength, his sense of humor, his love of the outdoors, his leadership, his love for Sandra, have all been left as part of his legacy. Dan continues to live on in the faces of his brother and in the hearts of all of you through the memories and the stories that will be told forevermore. Please welcome Terry, Sandra's sister, to read a poem.
So after all the tributes, the beautiful words that we've heard, the wonderful photos, and our own memories of our time spent with Dan, I think it leaves us all with a special, warm, fuzzy feeling, and Sandra has aptly chosen a poem called Afterglow. I'd like the memory of me to be a happy one. I'd like to leave an afterglow of smiles when life is done. I'd like to leave an echo whispering softly down the ways of happy times and laughing times and bright and sunny days. I'd like the tears of those who grieve to dry before the sun of happy memories that I leave when now my life is done.
Thank you, Terry. We have been remembering with love and gratitude a love that touched us all. Let's also remember to bless each day and to live it to the fullest in honor of life itself and of Dan. We often take life for granted, and yet it's the greatest gift we have. Daniel William Anthony Urbanowski, in love we leave you in peace, and with respect we bid you farewell. Rest in peace. At this time, I'm going to ask the family to stay seated and the rest of the guests to stand.
Somewhere over the rainbow. The dream that you dare to, why?